I am Nivedita, and
I'm Srihari.
And today we're going to talk about our experience in building an experimentation platform in Clojure.
So we're both from Nilenso, and Nilenso is a software cooperative based in Bangalore.
So over the last year and a half, we have worked with a subsidiary of Staples called Staples Parks, which uses machine learning, predictive modeling, and other distributed systems to make niche products for Staples. What we have built with them is a multivariate testing platform, which serves all of experimentation's needs of Staples through one box. These are some magnitude of data and sessions to give you an idea and perspective for the rest of the talk. We have a very strict SLA of 99.9 percentile at 10 milliseconds as we sit synchronously between all requests that go through staples.com.
So here is roughly what you'll take away from this talk. You'll learn about various ways in which you can set up your experiments. You'll learn that traffic is precious, I've said it once now, and how to use it efficiently. And you'll learn some like nice things about Clojure, and you'll see some really good examples. And you'll also see that you can build nice, beautiful assembly lines using Clojure, something that we should do more of. And you'll also see how you can test a complex system using simulation testing.
So this would be the overall structure of the talk. We'll spend some time explaining in brief the domain of experimentation, especially in context of the app we have built. Then we'll go into the implementation details of the app, and then we'll talk about how we tested the app using simulation testing. So the first portion of the talk, the domain itself, science. So the scientific method has been in use by humans since the 17th century, where we propose a hypothesis, test it, do some measurements around it, and then based on the measurements that we did during an experiment on that hypothesis, we say the hypothesis was correct or incorrect. Experimentation is a step in the scientific method which lets us prove, compare two competing hypotheses. So for example, the most common example would be a vaccine trial where you could divide your target population into two groups of control group and treatment group, where the control group doesn't get any vaccine or gets a vaccine that is already there in the market, and the test group would get the vaccine that you're trying to put in the market. So then, after a certain period of time, you would compare the test group against the control group to see how effective the vaccine has been.
So historically, experimentation has been used extensively in, say, medicine or genetics, but more recently, we are doing this to businesses, right? We are evaluating business ideas against each other, and we want to compare, say, which one is better than the other. And the basic underlying fact is that we use hard data to make decisions.
And by experiment, we mean controlled experiment specifically.
So we'll go through a few basic terms before we jump into the details of experiment infrastructure. But say something like a hypothesis, right? Like a term like a hypothesis can use some explanation. It can be as simple as, say, on the web, a red button is more compelling than a blue button, or the other way. You can also say that one model for like making an offer to a user is more effective than another model. Or say you can even evaluate entire products, like say, I've been using an email service for 5 years and I want to test a new one, but I'm not sure which one to use. But like you can use experiments to make your decision. And like say even like you're comparing different coupon services or something. Another such keyword that we'd use a lot is treatment. And we colloquially refer to it as a bucket. And we'd use this, we will be using this interchangeably through the doc. So a treatment is basically like the value for a variable in your system, right? Like imagine your red-blue experiment. So the color is the variable, and the values red or blue would be the treatment. And typically what you have in an experiment is a control treatment and a test treatment. So control is effectively no treatment, and test is your hypothesis. And there's no need for your experiment to be restricted to only two treatments. You can have as many treatments as you want, say red, blue, green.
Another term we use is coverage. So for example, you're testing a recommendation engine using our experimentation platform. And we tell the recommendation engine, yes, give a recommendation on this product. But when they try and apply this treatment on real time, they figure out that the product that they're giving recommendation on is actually out of stock. So they can't really give this recommendation. So they do not confirm that treatment with us. What they do is, so that particular session or that particular user for which the recommendation was being given should not be considered part of the experiment. So when we are measuring the experiment's success, we should not say that the purchase made by that user was because of the recommendation that we said we should give, because we did not really show it. So coverage of a treatment is very fundamental in ensuring the precise measurement of an experiment. What we do in our system is, by design, we assume every treatment that we give out to our clients will not be shown. So there's an explicit acknowledgement or explicit confirmation required from the client side. The client says that, I have applied the treatment that you have provided, so please consider this particular user, this particular session, as part of the experiment.
And it's quite fundamental because, say, in our case, say, only 10% of the actual traffic is covered, so it really skews your metrics if you're not looking at coverage. So here are, for example, the sequence of interactions. Like, we are not getting to any closure yet, but there's lots coming. So just, like, the domain is kind of heavy, so, like, we want to get through those parts before we show you the closure so that it's actually meaningful. So here is, for example, the sequence of interactions that you and I will have. Say you're the client of the experimentation platform. Say I'm the experimentation platform. So first you say, oh, there's a new user. Here's the user, or here's what the session ID of the user is. And then I'm like, okay. And then you're like, give me the treatments for this guy. And say, I want the checkout page wala experiment, and I want the red blue experiment. And then I give you the buckets for that guy. And then you're like, oh, I actually showed the button to this guy. And then you're like, you tell me that you showed it. And that's the confirmed treatment call. And then you're like, this guy did something interesting. So he's like, he made a purchase or something. And you want to let me know that this thing happened, because you later want to measure against it, right? Like, you want to say, how many sales dollars has this thing made over the other, or what's the margin, or something like that.
So now we'll go through the basic infrastructure, experiment infrastructure. The most basic of an experiment can be where you have one experiment and you have two treatments under it, control and test. And you divide your user or the traffic that comes to your system into these two buckets. And then control can be essentially no treatment, and test will be the hypothesis that you're trying to test. And then you run your experiment for a certain period of time, and then you compare the measurements of test against control. In this case, traffic is split between control and test only.
And like we said before, it's not restricted to only two. So you can have as many treatments as you want, but note that the traffic is split between them. And then you're free to compare as many treatments as you want. So you can compare control against test one, or control against test two, or even test one against test two.
So once you've set up your experiment, you want to run multiple experiments at the same time. One way to do this would be to share traffic between them. This would be the messy way of running. The term messy is not really used in
literature.
The domain. We have used it because. So you share the traffic between two experiments that you're running parallelly. So a user which comes into your system can be part of both experiment one and experiment two. This type of experiment setup is useful when you're trying to test two orthogonal hypotheses. For example, if you have an experiment running on the home page of your system and on the checkout page of your system, you know that the user will not be affected by these two experiments. So the measurement of experiment one will not be affected by experiment two. So hence the orthogonal hypothesis.
So another way you can run experiments at the same time is by splitting the traffic between them. And you do this normally when you want precise measurements in each experiment. A silly example would be, say, you're doing some experiments on your checkout page, and you've changed both the typeface and the button color, okay? And then you say, you're not really sure if the typeface is more compelling or the button is more compelling, but you want to make sure that whatever decisions you make, it's well-informed and precise. So what you do is you run them with split traffic, so a person who sees the typeface change will never see the button change, and vice versa. And that's it. You'll see that the traffic is split at all places, so this is quite expensive.
So this is the first setup we went into production with in our experimentation platform, where we allowed a client to run both messy experiments and precise experiments at the same time. So the way we did this, we would split the traffic at the top level into precise and messy, and the portions of traffic that go into precise will be split into other precise experiments, and the portion of traffic that go into messy will become part of all the experiments, which can potentially become part of all the messy experiments. So yeah, this is the first version we went into production with. After we were in production for a couple of months, we realized this one important lesson, that traffic is precious. Splitting of traffic at every level on every experiment makes it very hard to make measurements, like see the performance of the experiment in a very quick manner. So for example, for us, it took 4 weeks of running an experiment with 100% traffic, 100% of Staples traffic, to get any statistical significant data for that particular experiment, which was pretty expensive because we wanted quick feedback loop. We wanted to run experiments on smaller portions of traffic in a more finer, granular manner.
And this is not only true for Staples, right? Actually, like, for example, Google also says the exact same things. And this next model that we went to production with is actually something that's inspired by Google's paper. And we are calling it the nested or the layered model, wherein it's basically a tree, right? So this structure gives us all the benefits that we would get from the precise and messy model, except that it gives us finer control over traffic. So we can restrict the traffic for an experiment with exactly the kind of traffic, the kind of people that we want to put into that experiment. And how we have done the nesting is that an experiment can be nested under the bucket of another experiment. So to give you a more illustrative example, I'm sorry, the colors have really gone out, but so you have, like, say, three experiments at the top level: checkout, super labs, and search, right? And super labs is, say, your fictitious experiment, right? So what you want to do is, say, compare the world of mutants, and you want to compare them against the world of immutants, right? So that's your top level division right there. And say in the world of mutants, you want to compare the powers of adamantium, and say you want to compare it against you also want to test the powers of telepathy, right? So what you do is you run them parallelly, and that's no split of traffic. So adamantium and telepathy are running parallelly. And within adamantium, you want to test the powers of adamantium in, say, Wolverine's bones, or, say, in Ultron's shell, right? So at this point, you want to ensure that your measurement is precise, and hence you split the traffic between them. And because it's split, it's not split between adamantium and telepathy. Say if I'm in the world of mutants and I'm being experimented on, then I can be like a Jean Grey with Wolverine's bones, or like a Professor X with Wolverine's bone, or Ultron's shell, right? And what I can also do with this model is that if I want to run an experiment on all the Wolverines, I can do that, and I can restrict it to only the Wolverines, right? And this is something that I could never fathom doing in the older model.
This is the same setup in the previous slide, using a different visualization, a layered visualization, which is used by the Google overlapping in experiments infrastructure paper. So this is same model, but cut into layers. Each layer is orthogonal to each other again. So traffic is essentially shared between each layer of experiments. A traffic slice through a layer is essentially given the same treatment. So in this case, if I slice my traffic from here, every person in that traffic slice will get a mutant's treatment. And if I slice my traffic from here, every person in that traffic slice will get Claw, Wolverine, and Jean Grey treatment. The interesting part here is that immutants is a shared control group for all the mutants. So I can compare Wolverine to immutants, I can compare Ultron to immutants, and I can compare all the mutants together with immutants. So here you can clearly see that this is a shared control for all these experiments running, which is done in, wow, the colors are not really visible at all, but I'll use the pointer, which is done in R structure by using a shared bucket. This essentially is supposed to be a different color from the rest. This is the shared immutants bucket, which can be compared against these buckets, these Wolverine, Ultron, Jean Grey, and Professor X. If we did not have a concept of shared bucket, we would have to sacrifice some traffic here under adamantium to have a control group for Wolverine to compare them to compare Wolverine to immutants. So to because again, traffic is precious. We can't split traffic at every single level. So that's when, again, shared buckets help us make use of traffic efficiently.
So another one of the things that is quite vital to any experimentation platform is to basically null test, right? So an AA test is that. It helps you remove the possibility of the null hypothesis. So what it does is basically compare a treatment against itself. Right? So you have an A bucket, say, and you're dividing it into A1 and A2. That's basically the same traffic, but it's getting split. And what it helps you do is that, for example, there is some randomness, right? You want to ensure that the treatment is responsible for your measurements and not just some randomness. So you know that when, say, reports on A1 and A2 are sort of similar, you know that you have attained statistical significance in the traffic. And what it also helps you do is test the experimentation platform itself, in that we don't have any bias in the way we are bucketing users.
So
let us know if that's not, is that legible? Can people read that? Sorry, there's something wrong with the converter.
So the most frequent question people ask us when we explain the thing that we're building is, why not use a third-party app? Which is out there, like Kissmetrics or Optimizely or any other such app. So we've thought about that, and there are reasons why we can't use them or why we wanted to build it ourselves. So we wanted to be able to run multiple experiments over the traffic that comes into our system, but not only that, we wanted to have a finer gain control over how the traffic flows over all our through all our experiments. Second, our platform is very e-commerce opinionated. The data we collect and the metrics we report on are metrics like margin, conversion, and sales dollars, which again is like our system is very built to measure these metrics in a very good way. We really needed low latency because again, if you go to staples.com right now and search for a product, staples.com is asking us which search algorithm should I use for doing this search and then giving you the result. So we're sitting in every single request that goes through staples.com, and that's why we need to be very fast. We needed real-time reports because that's the thing people want. They want to see the performance of the experiments that they're running as they're running it, not after 2 months or not after a certain period of time. We wanted to have this feature called controlled ramp-ups of experiments. So if you're running a risky experiment, a new model that our data scientists came up with, which they're not sure of how it will actually work in the real world. So you don't want to assign 100% traffic or a huge chunk of your traffic. You don't want to expose a huge chunk of your traffic to that experiment, to that risky experiment. So you start with a very small amount of traffic. Start with 10%, you start with 5%. And then as the time goes by, as you get the feedback from that, using our real-time reports, as you get feedback on that experiment, you increase the amount of traffic that goes through it. And through that increase, through the ramp up of the traffic, you want to ensure stickiness. That is also an important thing that we learned, that as you're changing the traffic that goes through the experiment, you want to ensure that if a person that had received one treatment in the beginning of the experiment should receive the same treatment till the end of the experiment. layered experiments, and we wanted statistically sound data, which can be audited by our data scientists and other people. And again, we wanted to build a system that can be very deeply integrated with other systems in our client's ecosystem, so that we can leverage the data from other systems as well, in addition to the data that we collect.
We're calling the slide Parantu because we didn't really come up with another better word. That basically means, but watch out for these things. So if you do decide to build something like this by yourself, you need to understand that it's quite complex. You'll have to read thick statistics books. And the fields is like in the experimental, in the research phase for the finer details. And you will have to read some white papers to understand a few things better. And it's a significant investment of time, right? Like if Google, Netflix, or Microsoft are any examples, it takes them years to build this. It has taken us years to build this and years to get right. So understand that it's a big undertaking. And for all you know, what you need is a third-party service that gives you like quick access, and you just want to get it up and running. And you should try it out before you're sure that you want something like this.
And of course, we didn't build it ourselves. We had a team of statisticians there to help us. The next section is the implementation detail of the system that we built. So this is the sort of the overall structure of the system. It's not very complex, but there are four major parts to this system: the API service, the reporting service, the Postgres cluster, and the ETL service. We'll go into a little more detail with each of these things in a bit, but as a brief explanation, the API service is the one that serves all the client's runtime needs, where they start a session with us, they ask us for treatments, we give them treatments, they confirm a treatment, they record events saying purchase has happened. So all that happens here. This is the portion where they set up an experiment and the scheduling of the experiment and all that, and they report on the experiment. The cluster is essentially the state of all our functionally written code. So we have actually, we maintain a Postgres cluster ourselves, where we have one master and three standbys. One of the standbys act as a reporting DB. We'll talk about it in a bit. Then we have an ETL service, which again is written in Clojure, which talks to Redshift and our API service.
So in the API service, one of the more interesting parts is how we bucket users, right? And here's a simplified version of that. And I'll walk through this really quickly. So what this is basically a tree traversal. So we walk the tree breadth first, and like for each level of experiments, for each experiment, we bucket you. And the way we bucket you is ensure that if you have been given a bucket before, we give that back to you. And that's on multiple levels, right? Like during this session, on that device, on that group of devices, we ensure that you get the same treatment. And if you haven't been assigned to this experiment before, we roll a fair die and put you into one of these treatments and give that back to you.
So the Postgres cluster we talked about, again, this is a functional conf. I don't want to go into details of it. But since ours is a very data-centered domain, we wanted to ensure that the data that we save has integrity and we don't lose a lot of data. So we need a very quick failover mechanism. If our database crashes, we need a very quick way of making sure that another database comes up in place of it and we're able to write to it. So we were using Postgres as our runtime database, because again, it's awesome. As a OLTP database, at least. There was no out-of-the-box Postgres cluster management tool out there which we could use. RDS at that point did not have read replicas for Postgres when we started building this thing. And even with RDS, I don't think there's a failover mechanism in place. So we built it ourselves using a tool called Rep Manager, which Second Quadrant builds and maintains. It's an open source tool. So what it does is you essentially have a cluster of nodes. It's not that, it's a very simple leader selection process that is done in Rep Manager, where if a node fails, the rest of the nodes select a new leader, and that comes up as a new master, and the rest of the nodes start streaming from it continuously. The interesting part was the multiple lines of defense we built against such failover scenario, not just at the cluster level, but inside our application itself. So the first line of defense is, of course, when such thing happens, the cluster itself, the rep manager itself, pushes a notification to all our application servers that, hey, your master node has changed. Figure out, make sure you're writing to the correct one. Then the next level of defense was, of course, all our applications keep polling for the master. They keep checking, can I write to this master? Can I write to the master? Can I write to the master? The moment they say, I cannot write to the master, they have a list of standbys. They can figure out which of these I can write to, and then they start writing to the new one. Because in our cluster, only the master is writable. Rest all are hot standbys, which are read-only by default in Postgres. The last thing that we used, we did, was using ZFS instead of the regular file system on Ubuntu. ZFS allows us to have mirrors and incremental snapshots, which can be backed up and recovered from very easily.
So the other side of the experimentation is where you measure things, right? So we did, we do most of our real-time measurement in Postgres. And what we feel is that Postgres has the sweet spot, right? That it's not great as a warehouse. It's not, say, as good as Redshift with months of data. But what it is good is that you give it 300 to 500 gigs of data, and it's really good at pulling reports really fast on them. But another restriction that we had is that since we built it as a cluster and the database is streaming live from the master, we have to use the same schema as the master. So we don't have a separate reporting schema. What we did was changed what's underneath. So we configured a file system and the hardware to read as fast as possible from disk. And that's what we essentially need for large queries. And so we actually did end up doing a lot of crazy Postgres optimizations, and you can come to us later for that. And here's another parantu, is that maintenance is sometimes definitely underestimated. With respect to Postgres, the reclamation of, like, we do have a purge strategy in place in an ever-increasing DB, but the reclamation of space and reuse of space is still sort of an unsolved problem for us. And here's a shout out to the PostgreSQL community. We've gone loads of times to IRC on Freenode, and they've always given us answers or explanations.
So Postgres provided us with the real-time reports that we needed, but we still needed a way to report on historical data, like year and months of data that we have recorded so far in our experimentation platform. So we thought of using a real OLAP solution. So we tried GreenPlum as the OLAP solution because, again, it was a cluster over on top of Postgres. The loading reporting was pretty fast. It even had the upsert or the merge strategy, which most of the OLAP solutions lack when loading the data into it. But again, it's not hosted, and maintaining and standing up the cluster in GreenPlum, at least to untrained people like me, seemed very expensive. So we used, again, Amazon's Redshift. That's pretty well maintained by Amazon. And the reason we used it was not only that. We already had other systems in our client's office which were using it, and we wanted to be able to report across systems again. So we went with the same data warehouse. So to move data from our system to the OLAP DB that we had, Redshift, we used we built an ETL service for it. So the way it worked was, we had events, stream of events that our API sends out and writes to the disk, and that goes to S3. Those event files are then pulled from S3 using our ETL. The ETL service pulls those things from S3, transforms them, and loads them to Redshift. All of them, this was written as an assembly line, which was built using Core Async. So this essentially sums up the entire ETL process that we had to do. And you can see, like, this is essentially all written in Core Async. Core Async gives you a thing called a pipeline, which has one input channel, one output channel, and it takes a transducer, which transforms things from the input channel and puts them onto an output channel. So if you can imagine all these steps in the ETL process as different groups of people in a factory with an assembly line. So extract process is done by that many number, and the second parameter to the pipeline is how many threads you want to run for that particular job. So that many number of people in a factory doing that job, extracting data and putting into another conveyor belt for the transform job to pick that up and start doing its thing. So this is essentially, an assembly line.
So apologies for coming to this so late in the talk, but we couldn't miss this. I would say one of the most beautiful examples of Clojure was the previous slide. But given that, let me go to this slide. I guess most of this slide can be summed up to we really like Clojure, and I really like Rich Hickey. To be honest, like, it really lets us focus on the actual problem. We've not found ourselves like trying to find out how something is implemented in Clojure. It's really expressive, right? The assembly line, we'll show you a lot of examples ahead also. And then we want to be on the JVM because we want to be fast, and we want the standard tools for debugging, profiling. And it's also, it was the established language of choice amongst all the teams at Sparks, and we wanted to leverage the Clojure talent. And it's not that we couldn't have written this in, like, say, Scala or Go, but, like, say we want to be on the JVM, we want a GC, and, like, we'd really like to spend a year learning Haskell, but we can't really afford that at the moment. So here is, say, another example of such of interesting expressive code. So if you remember the precise messy architecture, this code sits, like, sort of critically in between that. So what it does, what this code is basically a map. On the left-hand side is a vector of the sessions tag and the type of experiment you're requesting for. And the right-hand side is how to bucket it, right? So I find that really expressive. And I've found people who came to our team and like started ramping up on this ramp up pretty fast because of code like this.
So this is the graph of how we wanted to generate the report on the data we measure. So on top of this graph are the data, are the things that are actually recorded in our DB. And these are the computations we wanted to do to finally get to a value that is meaningful to our client to report on, to see in a report. So all this complicated graph maps onto Clojure in a beautiful way. So all the things you see on the left are the nodes on the graph, and on the right is a very expressive way of saying how that value is calculated. Oh yeah, this is me. So this is again another beautiful piece of code that, says how expressive Clojure is. This is a code of defining a state machine in Clojure. A state machine in Clojure, and where each row defines the transition of the system from one state to another. You can imagine your circles and arrows diagram that you draw in your automata class sitting and drawing. This is essentially mapping of that onto Clojure in a very beautiful way.
And we'll dig into this later when we go into simulation testing.
Yeah, we'll dig into this later.
And that is probably another moment for a nice anecdote. So one of the things that we normally try to normally find ourselves failing with Clojure is really understanding its laziness. So in the absence of good practices for understanding laziness in Clojure, you can really mess up pretty bad. So for example, you run a function in the REPL and it doesn't run, and you're like, why didn't that run? And then you'll be like, oh, it's lazy, that's why it didn't run. And so you have to like wrap it in a do block or something. And then say you're profiling something, right? And then your actual function doesn't show up in the profiler because it's lazy, and it shows up somewhere else in a function that you wouldn't expect, and that's bad. And the anecdote I was talking about was that we had an application cache, and we were putting things in it, and we were putting datomic datums. And one thing about datomic datums is that they have an index to the root of the database, inside a root of each of the four indexes. That means that it has a link to the entire database in every datum. And we were putting datums in the cache, but we were like, that shouldn't blow up anything. But we were noticing that we were like going up to 4 gigs and then crashing in out of memory errors. Turns out that we were putting a lazy seek into the cache, and that's obviously very embarrassing, and we had to have Stuart Halloway come and fix it for us, but it's embarrassing, but it's true, right? So it's something you need to watch out for.
Back to this, as Abhinav was telling us the other day, the way to fix this would be to have some sort of engineering practice where you realize your seeks at every layer of your architecture where your data is going out of one layer to another. You realize your lazy seeks and make sure that there's no realization left between two layers of code where they don't know what they're getting, essentially. So this is the last part of our talk. So we built a system. We thought it was working because all our tests were passing, all our unit tests, integration tests were passing. But you don't really know that your system is working until it's working in production. And since this was such a critical piece of code for our client to be put on production, they want to be really sure how to be sure that your code will work in production. Simulation testing is one such tool which will help you get that. So what they do is it lets you simulate the working of your system with real usage patterns and varying degrees of load that you will actually see into production. So we'll go into the detail of how it does that, how it allows you to go through your realistic usage pattern, but that is what we used to test it. So why test using simulation testing? Again, if you imagine your test pyramid where unit testing is on the low, in the lowermost part of the pyramid, and as you go up, there's integration tests, there's API level tests, there's your UI tests, there are your functional tests. Simulation testing sits on top of all of that because it is testing not the local parts of your application, but all of your application as a whole. And not just your application, but even if you want, the systems of application that is integrating with your application, like systems of all the subsystems, it can test as a whole. Again, other examples could be that humans can't, example-based testing, humans can't possibly think of all the possible test cases. And then, so you go from example-based testing to property testing. So simulation testing would be property testing at the system level on the outside, not at the local application level. The tools that we have used for simulation testing are Simulint, Causatum, and Datomic. So we, Simulint is a library and schema for developing simulation-based tests, which is written and maintained by Cognitech. It gives you abstractions like models, tests, and sims. Model is how you model is essentially how you define the different activities that happen in your system, and then based on the model, you define your test cases. Based on how what are the activities that can happen in your system, you define all your test cases, which are again generated. You don't have to define one of them, each of them separately, and then simulation is an instance of that test executed against your system. And again, all of this we'll go into a little bit detail later. Causatum is the library we use to generate streams of time-based events. And again, we'll go into the state machine that we give to Causatum after this. Datomic is the data store of choice because it works well with Simulint.
So this is sort of borrowed from Michael Nygaard's talk in Strange Loop, which you should watch. And it's a great explanation of the simulation testing tool that was used to build, that was used to test this exact system. And I'll go through it a little briefly here. So what you have is your system under test, the big circle, and the simulation runner there. So these are the like the two main important parts in this thing. So what you have is the activity model. So let's go through this from the top. So activity model is your state machine that describes user patterns on staples.com, say. And you generate a bunch of events from that state machine. So you're like, this is how like 100,000 users will behave on my system. And then you're going to like take this and give it to the simulation runner. And the simulation runner is going to run the sim, but what it has to do first is establish state on the target system, right? And you do that first. And once your target system is in an expected state, you run the sim. And when you're running the sim, you're going to record every single thing that happens in the sim. And that, not in a log, but in a database, right? So you have, at the end of a sim, right, you have the system's output and the entire log of the sim inside the database, which you can then use to run validations. So this is the state machine that Nid was explaining earlier, and I'll go into it a bit in a bit detail here. So all these keywords that you see here are basically states that you can be in as, say, a staples.com user, right? So what you can do, you can log in, you can make a purchase, you can say go to some special page that I make a note of, and things like that, right? So all those things are your states, and each row in this thing represents a state transition. So you can go from logging in to, like, say, a place where a promo is displayed. And the probability of the state transition is the third column. So you can say, what is the probability of this user going into that? And the last two columns are like, so there are some real-time constraints on how fast you can do two actions. So that is specified in the min delay. And the max delay is how, like, for example, if a session times out before you do something, you enforce that and say that your users have to behave this way. So that's like the max delay thing. So all these things are what go into causatum and give you a list of an event stream that you can then use to test your target system.
So the event stream that causatum generates is then, each of the event is then defined how that event will look like. So this is an example event. For example, here I'm asking my experimentation platform for give me treatments for some particular user. So the important things to note here is it makes the request and then it records it. If it gets an exception, it records it. That's the important part. Whatever happens, it just records whatever happened and moves on, because it's not asserting anything here. It's not waiting for some kind of special response from thing and then acting upon it. It's just recording everything and then moving on. So this would be the, so imagine your simulation testing as sort of a, you can compare simulation testing to functional programming in a way where you imagine the system under like the target system under testing, which you're trying to test, can be like imagined as a pure function. Pure function, not completely pure because it might have some state, but given a certain state, it should behave in the same manner. So you extract out the setting of state and the tearing down of state as an explicit step in your simulation. So before you run the simulation, you set up a certain state on your target system. You, in our case, it would be set up this merchant, set up this these experiments for that merchant, and some business rules that we need for that particular merchant. Then you run the bunch of the streams of events that you had generated, streams of activities that users can do on our system. And then you do it the tear down, where you say, okay, now I want the end state of your system. I gave you some state, I ran some simulation on you, and I want the end state, and I retrieve the reports. Then I run some cleanup that I need to do to put the system back into the state that it was.
And that brings us to how you actually write validations based on all the data you recorded. So like I said before, all the data, like the data that you get while running the simulation and the system state after, is inside the database. So your validation is essentially a single query. In our case, because we used Simulint in Datomic, our query is a simple data log query, which looks somewhat like this. And say, if a simple validation would be to assert that there were no 500s during the entire sim, you can do that by just saying, like, look at like the third line in. Imagine like look at the third line in the query. That's basically like look for any action log with an exception, and this assertion will fail if there were any such exception. Other examples of such validations could be that, say, I never assign two buckets of the same experiment to the same user, right? Or say, if my traffic distribution is 60-40 between two buckets, I ensure that at the end of my sim, and if I had, say, 1,000 users, 500 and 500 is the split. And or like with a certain error margin, and then you want to check that. So I can compute these reports, right? The reports that my experimentation platform will generate, I can do that in the sim, in the simulation testing platform. And so I can compare that report and the actual report of the system and ensure that they match as well.
So the simulation testing we used actually helped us find some critical bugs in our system which were actually missed by our QA team, and which were not bugs that we could see it happening, like we could see that. The other thing that this gives us, because you're recording everything that is happening in your system, right? You're not missing out anything. So you can run diagnostics on what happened, why things went wrong. So we found a bug that, okay, I gave two buckets of the same experiment for the user. Why did this happen? What was the state of the system when this happened? So in our simulation testing tool, this is a thing we run, say that print the timeline for the token. Token is the thing that identifies a session, and it gives a result like this. This is a very cropped out result of what the actual timeline looks like. So we can see that this is the portion, at this time the session started. This is the time it took for this target system to respond. At this point it did this request. This is the time it took to respond. This is the response it gave. What was the status code and all of that. And you can this will help diagnose the actual problem that you found in your system.
I think this is you. Sorry.
So all this is simulation testing again is really good, and we should definitely use it. But I would also like to point out a few things that are hard to do. It's hard to maintain the simulation testing tool that we have. For example, the testing suite, whatever if you want to call it, because you're testing a cluster of systems, right? Every system moves at its own pace. There's so many moving parts that if one system changes its API, you need to make sure that your simulation testing tool has been updated to that. So in the last 1.5 years, we had one or two people from the team dedicated to maintain and make sure that the testing tool has been up to date, is remaining up to date. Then again, the reason you run tests is to make it part of your development process, put it on CI. So imagine putting a unit test suite on CI for one service. That's easy. Imagine putting an integration test suite on CI. That's also easy. Imagine putting an end-to-end test. That's slightly hard. Imagine putting a browser test. That's also slightly hard. But all of that for n number of services that you're running, that becomes super hard. So when we were actually trying to put the simulation testing suite that we had on CI, and Embarrassed to say it, we couldn't, but it's still in the process. We'll get there. And then simulation testing can become part of your normal software delivery process, where every 3 hours, a simulation test is run against your system to make sure that all of your systems are working in the manner that they should.
So in conclusion, traffic is precious, and that's, I think, the fourth time I've said it. Keep that in mind. It's not just us, it's not just Staples, it's Google, it's everyone you can think of who's doing experimentation. Keep that in mind. And then you can build assembly lines in Clojure really well, and you should probably use that, and ETL is a good example of where you can use that. thanks for that. And test your system from the outside, use simulation testing, and yes, use Clojure. And here are some really good papers that we went through and books that we went through. These will remain on the slides, and we'll put them up somewhere. You can go through them later on. And that's it from us. Thanks. If you have any questions, we can take them now. Okay. Can you go to that slide, maybe? Okay,
sure.
All right. We can take this offline. Okay. Thanks.